Hello and welcome to episode 53 of the Adoption and Fostering Podcast, our Christmas special. Bah humbug. Bah humbug.
Oh, you miserable toad. It's great, man.
I know. And so, Al, how are you?
I'm really well, actually. I am.
That's fine. Thank you.
Okay.
And we're going to keep it short and sweet tonight. It's Christmas after
all. Setting the tone. You know,
people have got things to be done, things to do.
Brisk.
Anyway, we'll come back to you in a minute. So we've got a suddenly mummy.
Hello.
AKA Becky.
Yay.
Yay. Friend of the show.
Friend of the show.
Are actually, you Becky?
Yeah, she's not a guest anymore, is she? She's like...
she's a regular, really, isn't she? she's like our female kind of co-host now and again.
Oh.
I think.
Yeah.
Would that be a nice... That's a nice way to put
that. That's nice. That's a highly elevated status, really.
But the
as opposed to person you have on when you can't get anybody else.
Oh, she's cut me deep.
We are knocking down the door to get on this, I tell you. Honestly, no end of names. Anyway,
yeah, the cast of one.
Yeah,
but anyway, now you know. So now she's not a guest, though. That means she can get to do some of the work, doesn't it? Like,
yeah, that's right.
We don't have to make coffee for her. She has to make coffee now, make tea and biscuits and things.
Just to say, if there is any jobs that need doing, then obviously, you know, I don't really put it my way either. But you know, whatever.
Yeah, it hasn't gone unnoticed.
I just... Oh, is it annual review time again?
don't even go there.
So anyway, tonight is a kind of more relaxed affair to the podcast, but obviously we're going to be paying attention to the last year and maybe looking a bit ahead. It's all about the banter tonight. It's all about Christmas cheer and cheering you all up so that you enter into the Christmas spirit. If you actually get to listen to this before Christmas, because there's only a few days to go. So, right, Al, now you can speak. Now I've done my lovely intro, welcoming everybody.
That's it. Have a sip of your fizzy pop. So, Becky, how are you? And I think it's important that we catch up. Tell me about your life and what you've been doing since we last spoke to you.
Well, when did we last speak? Sort of the summer?
May.
May, was it?
You'd just been engaged.
Ah, July, it would have been then. Oh. So more recently than you thought.
Just don't, oh, hello. Don't ask him to remember your... Harry, stop. Hey. That's great, isn't it? That's just...
Noise is off. I'm loving that.
Yeah, paper professional.
I'll get the newspaper on his snout in a minute. No, I'm joking.
So
don't ask Al to remember any anniversaries, will you? You know,
no,
July.
No.
There's a bit of a difference there.
Yeah, it's all the same.
Yeah,
things are good. Things are good. I'm still engaged, so I think that's probably.
That's a record. Yeah.
Is it record? Still engaged. Yeah, we've booked things. I've booked and paid for a lot of wedding-related things.
Oh. What sort of wedding-relating things? Invites?
Oh, in what?
Invites.
I believe we touched on this the last time, didn't we? It's not happening now.
Believe it or not, I haven't actually sent the invitations, any invitations to anybody. Currently, nobody's coming to my wedding.
Well, I presumed that as I'd not got one.
Yeah, well, that's it. Just keep looking in the post. It's probably the Christmas. You know, it's very busy, the post,
very
over
busy,
Christmas.
Very busy. Very
and if you don't get one by then...
Christmas cards in the sorting office. Or...
Yeah, if you don't get one by the end of March, then don't bother looking for it because it's been and gone. So there
it's
you
probably
go.
Not coming then. It's probably lost.
I won't hold my breath. Oh, well. And how are your children?
They are pretty good. They've been poorly, actually, for... ages, but they're sort of recovering now, so they're not bad.
It's the season, isn't it? It's the poolie season.
It is the interminable cough and cold season.
Yes.
Which is very dull. And it is, because like one of them comes on from somewhere with some awful germ, and then everyone in the family gets it, and then it just keeps going round after that forever. It's never ending coughing and bodily fluids.
Oh, I'm sick of it. I feel like I've been at this for years, and this horrible thing happened to me yesterday. I had this palpable feeling. It was all involved Peppa Pig, Can I speak ill of Peppa Pig?
Yes, you may. Right.
It just dawned on me that, because my, well, it's a long story short, but one of my grandchildren lives in my house now, with their mother, fortunately. And this little thing, this little person was watching, Peppa Pig was on, and they were watching it, and I thought, and I had this, like, cold chill ran through me, thought, I've got another 5 years of Peppa Pig.
Yes.
Another 5 years. And I thought, this is my...
And after that, Ben and Holly, and all of the other ones.
I don't mind Ben and Holly, but I just thought, I'm not sure I can do it. I'm not... I had this, like, really wobble. I just... like almost like a panic attack where I thought I'm not sure. Actually, I'm getting quite emotional talking about it because I thought I just that incessant oh Peppa, where did you get that crack cocaine, that kind of thing that goes on and I'm upset about it already, so that's maybe 15 years of Peppa Pig I'll have had by the end of it anyway.
Oh, it's brutal.
Well, can I just tell you, I haven't had to live through Peppa Pig, obviously, because they've all been too old when they've got to me, and I am so grateful for that. It was,
yeah, you should be.
I mean, it's Tracy Beaker and that Phineas and Ferb, or Ferb, I think. That's what I've had to suffer. And I can tell you the theme tune, I can actually sing the theme tune to Phineas and Ferb. I'm not going to, but I could if I wanted to.
My son has just turned 8, and he's graduated to a world of cartoons, which are populated by... really, creatures that can only be the result of a drug-induced state. I'm just, what is that blob? Why has that blob got bogies for eyes? Why are they all speaking like that? What is that? I couldn't tell you the names of any of the programs he watches now, except that every one of them is completely LSD heavy. I can't think of any other reason why anything like that would have been created. I have no idea what's happening. I used to quite enjoy Lego Ninjago.
You are a dark horse, Becky White, as always. You are.
Well, I'm a big fan. The only problem with Lego Ninjago is there's about 8 series of it, and you only get to, with your child, you only get to watch random episodes.
Yeah.
So you'll turn it on, and they're at this point in the storyline, and the next time he comes and watches it, there's like 5 new characters, and they're all wearing different clothes, and you've no idea what's happening. And I did at one point think, I'd quite like to sit down and watch this from the start and see what happens in the story. And then I gave myself a good talking to and got on with my life.
Yeah, wise. Probably a good idea.
Well, I had a really... I was going to say that I had very, very, very early on in my parenting, I realised that I would go criminally insane if I was to track my children's viewing habits and sit down like one of these parents you see on the telly. So I made this decision that I would not watch any full episode of anything they were watching. So to this day, I have yet to see the full extent of the film Annie. So every time I sit down, I go, oh, I've not seen this bit. I've not heard this song. Because my children, I probably said this before on the podcast, the first thing my kids did, the oldest three, when they walked into my house and they said, can we watch a film? I said, oh, that's a great idea. They said, can we watch Annie? And I said...
You freaked.
Well, I did. I said, no, I'm not sure you can. I think that there must be a really good reason why we can't. So I had to have a talk to the good Mrs. C, and she said, don't be stupid. A common theme in our relationship. And so they watched it, but I was just freaked out. Even to this day, I just feel a bit unsettled. But there's been all that hoo-ha, hasn't there, about adoption on the telly, but we'll not get into that. Anyway.
No, let's not. Let's not.
So, do you know what... But, Becky, when did your son become 8? I thought he was, like, 4.
Yeah, I know, it's a bit weird, isn't it? Someone said to me the other day, he turned 8, and someone said to me, what, it doesn't seem 2 minutes since he took his first steps in our lounge. And I was like, I know, it's blinking horrifying. He's 8, and he's 18 feet tall, and he has massive, enormous feet. He's huge. And he had his birthday, and then the next day, none of his T-shirts fitted anymore. It was like he grew 4 inches overnight or something. And now the sleeves of his T-shirts end at his elbows all of a sudden, and he's just huge. So in the run-up to Christmas, we have my son's birthday a month before Christmas, and then exactly 2 weeks before Christmas, we have my daughter's birthday. And then we have Christmas in England, which was today. And then we all fly to France and we have another Christmas. So November and December for me is just a whitewash, really. You're going to ask me what I've done over the year. I can't remember. All I can tell you about now is birthday cakes and present wrapping and finding batteries for things because nothing comes with batteries. Mm. And so managing expectations.
Why? What possesses you to have 2 Christmases? I don't quite understand why you would put yourself through that.
I know, it's logistics because... We fly to France every Christmas to spend Christmas with family. And I actually just can't fit all the presents in the bag. I can't take all their presents to France and then all the presents for all the rest of the family and then bring back. So it's not doable. And so we settled a long time ago on just having two Christmases, basically. We have a low-key Christmas in England, which I say we had today. So that was quite nice. And then a slightly more traditional Christmas.
Did your new man approve of such shenanigans?
I didn't really ask him. I just laid out the plan. This is the plan.
Setting the ground rules from the very outset. This is how it is.
Yeah, like this is how we'll be doing this.
Yeah,
I do have a question for you, though, about in relation to your business, because you don't blog as much anymore.
No, I'm just really lazy, it turns out. No, there have been several reasons why I've not been blogging as much. One is the fact that I have a companion of an evening sometimes now, and it's just apparently it's quite rude if your boyfriend comes round to then spend the entire evening blogging on your computer and paying no attention to him. So that's new. And I've been writing other things. Oh. There have been other things to be written.
Share with the group. Can you share what those other things were?
Can I share? Scott, can I share? I don't know.
I'm not sure if you can. I don't know.
What?
I'm sure you can. It's written.
Yeah, it's written. There is 65,000 words worth of book manuscripts just been sent to JKP, which I have written with my own laptop.
Wow, steam coming out the back.
It's been a bit of a project this year. So it's kind of taken up some of the sort of writing. It's taken the steam off the writing, really. There's been plenty. I mean, I've absolutely enjoyed doing it. So I've not found it a chore, particularly. But I feel like I've written myself out when I've written that. It's finished now, so there might be some more.
And is there
kind of spare writing space left for blogging? I don't know.
What is it? The history of cheese making in the 18th century? What is it?
Gosh, I'll hand you. Gosh, that's just getting it straight out the door like that. That's unbelievable.
Hit the nail on the head. I'm presuming it's adoption related.
It is 65,000 words on attachment and trauma in the classroom.
Well, how to, how not to, that sort of thing.
Yeah, it's meant to be. It's a practical approach. Oh. It's a little bit. It's not quite the same, but it's got some. If you've read Sarah Nish's A to Z of Therapeutic Parenting, which has got some kind of approach of here are some things that could happen and here are some things you can try. It's that kind of approach, but more in a classroom school setting.
So it's like the something for teachers.
Yeah, but there's not. Yeah, but not in an A to Z format or in any way, like not copied off Sarah's book at all.
We'll just make that clear and our
for
lawyers...
copyright reasons, yeah.
Entirely not plagiarised from someone else's book. No, but the chapters are along the lines of, like, there's a whole chapter on managing transitions. There's a whole chapter on homework and exams and revision. There's a whole chapter on, like, playtime and lunchtime and managing that time.
So is that focused at parents or teachers?
It's aimed at teachers.
And when will that be coming out?
September.
Oh, hell's teeth. JKP need to get the finger out, don't they?
No, I think they've timed it on purpose. I think it's timed to fit in with other publications they've got coming out. And also because there isn't really a lot of point in publishing a book aimed at teachers.
At
the end of the year, at the end of the school year. So I think they've aimed to start it. To get it out there in September to coincide with the start of the new school year. So it's kind of exciting because now I'm getting emails that say, do you like this front cover or this front cover? Do you like this front cover or this front cover? And it is like being at the opticians. I don't know, you've shown me 10 front covers.
Which one fits my face? That's what you should say. Which one fits my face?
Just a big picture of my face with the title tattooed on the forehead.
Yeah. You should have a picture of Scott in a mortarboard and a cape. And in front of a blackboard saying everything you ever wanted to know about teaching children in school but never dared to ask. Something like that.
Yeah.
I'm quite excited with it, though. There are some case studies. In doing it, I've managed to get to speak to some extraordinary teachers and head teachers, really extraordinary people who are like trailblazers, really, who've really taken some really brave decisions in their schools and whose Ofsted and HMI reports back up what they're doing 100%. So it's fantastic to be able to speak to people who are doing this, really, really doing it, and can show you good practical examples. And also, Ofsted approves of it. The behaviour of the school is good. Attainment is good. Attendance is good. All the things, all the catastrophic things that, that people say will happen if you adopt a relational approach to behaviour management are not happening in these people's schools. That it is possible to adopt this kind of compassionate approach that takes the child where they're at and manages those expectations and does all of that trauma-informed stuff and still have a well-run school that educates all the kids that come to it. So I know I'm like on a soapbox now, but thinking, like this, it's gold, really. It's gold.
I've been offered a cup of tea. I mean, clearly, I mean, that's all wonderful, but the key question is, will I get a copy to review on the podcast?
Well, yeah, well, I shall speak to my, whoever it is I speak to.
Your publisher, love. Your publisher. You're going to be a published author.
Get you, that's so jazzy.
I know, and shall I tell you, I can't tell you now what it will be, but I obviously, by the time the book is published, I'll be married.
Oh.
And I am going to take my husband's name for a lot of reasons, but it will be extremely convenient for me to get a new name at this point in things. And so when the book is published, it will be published.
Hang on, stop, no, stop, stop, stop. It'd be extremely convenient for me to get a new name. Are you on the run from the police? Are your credit limits? Credit limits are broke bust.
Those CCJs are catching up on her, aren't they?
Yeah, they're coming for me now. They're coming for me. Is that a knock at the door? No, it just will be a useful thing to have a different name just because my birth children's families know my actual name.
So that's why you're having a holiday in France.
Yeah, that's right. So I'm fully intending to take my husband's name. And what's weird about it is probably about 10 to 15 years ago, for a long time I thought it would be lovely to write a book. You know, like everyone does. I'd love to write a book. And similar to what I did with my blog, really, which was I decided to have a blog and named it about 3 years before I actually started it. Mm-hmm. I decided that I'd write a book at some point in my life and chose a pseudonym for... I don't know why I would do this, but I thought, oh, it'd be great to use a pseudonym. I'll choose this name as a pseudonym.
Was it mysterious?
What's really very weird is when I get married, the name I chose as a pseudonym 15 years ago will be my actual name.
How funny.
So I will put it up, and it will be in that name, and it will be my actual name, which is just the weirdest thing. I mean, it slightly freaks me out.
I would be freaked out.
It's very freaky.
You mean he's been stalking your mind?
Yeah,
or something
that's what it'll be, not just a coincidence at all.
No, I'm really excited we're talking about books because, there's lots of things going around with books, but my quiz this year is book-based, the Christmas quiz. Don't laugh. Honestly, I sat and I prepared this Christmas quiz.
We're not laughing.
No, we're really not laughing. Bourbon or bourbon?
Shut your mouth.
You're both wrong, it's bourbon.
Shut your mouth. Right, so I did this, and I sat with my headphones on in the living room, and I was chuckling. I couldn't stop. I was amusing myself so much. We'll do that later, though, because that's just a teaser. I'll give you the name of the. Shall I give you the name of the quiz? It's called Memoir or Made Up. There you go.
Memoir. Okay, that's a bit of a tease going on there. Memoir.
Stay tuned, listeners.
Yeah. Listeners, it's not.
Listener.
Sorry, stay tuned, listener.
Yeah, it's listener. We know we've got one listener because we've just had an email, literally tonight.
From the Isle of Man.
Isle of Man.
From your listener?
Yeah.
Hey, listener.
Yeah.
Hey.
Shall I read out the first bit of it?
Yeah.
Because we don't want to give her too much away about her, because bless her, she's shared a lot, and we need... So basically, the email is worded as, Dear Al and Scott, hello, it is me, your listener from the Isle of Man. And yes, I do live on the Isle of Man, and I'm not just on holiday. However, I'm afraid this is where the disappointment may begin. I'm afraid I'm a bit of a fraud. I'm not an adopter, nor a foster care, or even a parent, for that matter. I'm actually a Senko. And while it was personal interest that initially drew me to your podcast, I found that the insight they've given me have really made me think and challenge my own approach to children. Their learning, but most importantly, their well-being. And I mean, the email is quite long, so I won't read the rest of that. But I read it and I was grinning from ear to ear to think that, you know, we mentioned Dial a Man out of complete jokes, And then she was driving along in the car, and she heard, she was listening to the podcast, and she heard us mention this listener on the Isle of Man.
That's so exciting.
But so, yeah, go on.
I'm mildly disappointed because I don't particularly want to go to the Isle of Man.
So, yeah, I know. We wanted to go to Mauritius, really, didn't we?
Yeah, we do have a listener in Mauritius.
Yeah.
I would like to go to the Isle of Man.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, we could do a little podcast kind of. Well, we could go there for your honeymoon. That's what we'll do. Becky's honeymoon. We'll go on the Isle of Man, right?
It's a lot closer to me than it is to either of you. I'm not that far from the Isle of Man, I guess, as the crow flies.
Well, as we're not getting a wedding invite, we'll come to the honeymoon instead.
Oh, good grief.
Seems reasonable. Seems fair.
So just say, I'm not going to give her name out, but thank you, Mrs. M, for your email. Honestly, I was grinning from ear to ear when Al sent it to me.
Can we give her a pseudonym? Can we call her Brenda from the Isle of Man?
You can call her whatever we like.
It's Brenda, our listener on the Isle of Man.
Hi, Brenda from the Isle of Man.
Hi, Brenda.
Thank you for emailing. It really was lovely. It really was.
Oh, yeah, and if people do want to email in and just abuse us, that's fine. We'll take that.
I know. I did say to Chris that I said, I wonder if people think that we get loads of emails. Because we do get some, but some podcasts must be really busy with kind of things going on and like lots of emails, especially when it's famous people that do it, but we're not famous, so that, you know, kind of quashes that one a little bit, doesn't it?
Somewhat.
Yeah. Anyway, yeah.
That's good. So, listeners, if you want to email Alan Scott and be gently mocked on their podcast, please feel free.
Yeah, we'll always mock you. Always.
Yeah.
It's a winner.
Well, I've got to maintain my registration, so one of the terms is that I don't bring social work into disrepute. And every week I listen to the podcast and I go, oh, too close. How far? How close to the edge am I getting? So, but I think I'm fine.
Is it? I don't think you are. I mean, you've had a few rants, but not to do with social work or anything.
Well, it's not social work. It's about bringing the profession into disrepute.
Oh, okay.
So if I was Larry...
I don't think you do that.
Well, no, not in public.
I mean, you've only turned up 3 or 4 times drunk, you know, I mean...
And I'm usually dressed.
Exactly, yeah. Yeah, drunk on your Pepsi Max. Other options are available.
It's all good stuff. So well done, Brenda. And now we're looking for some people who will live somewhere a bit warmer.
And who are willing to fund the flights as well.
That would really help. And the flights for all of our children too, which is
exactly, because we can't come alone, obviously. Well, actually, we could go alone, to be fair, actually. Yeah. No, I'm just fine with one adult flight. As long as it's in upper class, I'm fine.
It's fine. You're...
I don't ask for much on my runer, you know?
No. Your rider's relatively modest. Thinking about the last year, right, okay, because I was thinking across the last year, and it's a good time to reflect, and I like to reflect on what's gone on. So in a reflective sense, tell me what have been the high points and the low points of your years? Come on. What have been the... I mean, I guess it's obvious, you know, but not like in relation to adoption. What's been the good stuff? What's been the less than good stuff? Or fostering? So, Becky, come on.
Oh, you're asking me first. Gosh. High point. What, generally? Not, you mean personally or sort of?
Either, whatever. A
more general.
General.
General sort of.
Well, I know you're more involved in adoption kind of on a strategic level, aren't you? You know, work and stuff. You're on Radio 4, for heaven's sake, woman.
I think work-wise, probably the high point for me this year was just this surreal experience of being picked up from Euston train station at what I consider to be the absolute crack of dawn by a driver. Ferried across London to the BBC studios and being taken into the green room for a very short segment on Radio 4's Today programme. And did I tell you this on the last podcast?
You did,
because
mention,
I'm not.
It's worth repeating.
Is it really?
Yes, it's a class story.
Yeah.
So I'm in the green room and there's some people come in and there's a guy and a woman talking. And everyone that knows me knows that I've got no I really have no visual memory, so it's a miracle. If I know who you are when I see you, it's a miracle, because I don't remember faces, I don't remember names. And there was a guy and a woman talking in the green room, and I looked at the guy and thought, I think I know this guy. And then I thought, well, you know, he'll be famous, Becky. You know, he's on Radio 4. He'll be famous.
Is that your internal monologue? Is this how it goes?
Yes, this is my entire... This is. Believe me, when I meet you at a conference and you know exactly who I am and I'm looking at you with a slightly vacant expression on my face, this is what I'm doing. I'm trying to figure out where I might know you from. Because I'm just really bad at that. I'm terrible social skills. But it wasn't until the guy turned round to me and said good morning that I realised that it was actually Tony Blair. Stood in the room. And I was like, oh! So that was good. At which point I lost all, even any sense of social awareness that I've got, and just ignored him and poured myself an orange juice. So that went really well. And then the former Prime Minister of Australia came and sat down next to me. It was marvellous, and I got to speak to, I don't know, it was lovely. That was quite fun. But it was just the whole experience of being driven around by a driver and feeling like the Queen. So that was quite nice for my 4 minutes of fame on Radio 4's Today programme.
Well, I didn't know you were going to be on. I just was listening to Radio 4 by accident. Well, I'm middle class, but, you know, I was listening to it. And then it was like, oh, because they said Rebecca White, didn't they, as well?
Yeah. So, and they said, and then you said, it was this northern bird on Radio 4.
Bayek is like.
Yeah, by gum.
I use my special multi-purpose accent more.
They were probably just getting their quota up of the regions, weren't they?
Yeah, regional accents on. Yeah. So that was fun. And I had a really long interview on Radio 5 Live after that as well.
Did you?
More recently, which was quite fun.
How did you find that? Because that's really rock and roll. What was it about?
Yeah, really rock and roll.
Radio 5.
That was in response to whoever it was, who I should remember who it was, who said that the fall in adoptions is entirely down to the increase in IVF.
Oh, yeah. What's that all about?
Yeah. I suspect that the guy wasn't entirely reported. I suspect that wasn't the entire essence of what he said, actually. As is usually the case with these things. I think it's easy to pick up, isn't it, on a sentence from a headline from a news article and get terribly worked up. I suspect there was more to it than that.
That
because...
would never happen in the adoption community. I don't know. That's a harsh thing to say about this community. We're measured and responsible.
I bet you think all human beings have this tendency. I think sometimes things are not reported in the most helpful way to help us to understand what's really being said or happened. So I don't know what the guy actually said, but I know what was reported, and it was a bit off the mark. And somehow I got nearly 20 minutes on radio. Yeah. I think really, basically, the guy just couldn't make me stop. So once I'd started, it was just like, oh, she's still talking. And he was probably too polite to just cut me off.
Yeah, I'm kind of, I'm seeing where he would be going with that as well.
Yeah, you're familiar with the concept, right?
Do we need to go to news now? Something. I'm sure. Traffic.
That was nice.
Sally Traffic.
But it's not really, I mean, that's fun and all that. And it's kind of fun being on the radio and it's exciting. But it's not, the purpose of me being in London on that day was to launch the Equal Chance report that I'd been working on for months. And really, that was the point of that. So, it's kind of fun to get these opportunities to get the story out there, or help people to understand more generally what life is like for adoptive families, what kind of experiences people are having and what support people need. But actually, that support is going to come because it's legislated for, and having the opportunity to speak to those who are responsible for legislating for it is probably more important than your 2 minutes on Radio 4, really. You know, exciting though that is.
Yeah, fun and games. I mean, it's been an interesting year from a school development and a raising awareness of the impact of early adversity, because I guess one of my concerns, and it was maybe a question I had, not about that specifically, but it was about, because I often feel that we are privileged as adopters, and I know that's not necessarily a widely held view, but that we are just the tip of an iceberg of children who experience trauma and loss. And that was in your report, wasn't it?
Yes. And I think, this is a balance that we, you know, because obviously your listeners will know that I work for Adoption UK, and obviously Adoption UK is a charity that supports and represents adoptive families. That's the nature and the purpose of the charity. So obviously those are the voices we're mostly listening to and those are the views we're mostly representing. But I think we're increasingly, certainly in our education work, trying to make sure that people understand that trauma is everywhere. You know, in every class, there'll be children that are bereaved, children that have been through, children that are experienced. I think in some ways for us, that the more recent talk around this broader concept of adverse childhood experiences is really quite helpful. Because it helps people to have a context for all the things that can be impacting on a child's ability to settle and learn and get on at school and behave in the way you want them to and all of those things. I think children that are in care or that are in adopted or otherwise permanently placed are a kind of, perhaps, what can we say, like canary in the mine for that? Because for lots of those children, their needs are so great that as soon as things are out of balance in school, those children were the first ones where you start to see it going wrong. But if those, but then there's a whole raft of other children who also will be feeling the impacts of that, but maybe not expressing it quite so obviously. And I think this is part of the key part of the message, isn't it, really? We're not saying, can you make these changes for the sake of two children in your school? We're saying, if you make these changes, it'll benefit all the children in your school.
Yeah.
And could be transformative for those two particular ones, but it won't hurt anybody and will benefit all of them.
That's a great message. Yeah. I think that's important because I've been increasingly worried that as adopters that that as a community that we over-egg our pudding, that the other communities, because when you look at the special educational needs, is it 3 million children have got special educational needs?
Yeah, and obviously there's a lot of crossover between those communities and the adoption community and the special guardianship community and the kinship. There's a lot of crossover. Absolutely. A lot of adopted children have got special needs.
But then when you look at the numbers, if you talk about 50, I think it's roughly about 50, 55,000 children under 18 who are adoptees. That is a tiny minority. And you think if you want to bring on board those other communities, you want to link up and partner with them and do stuff.
Yeah.
Oh, it's got very sensible, though, hasn't it, this conversation? Because you are the education woman, aren't you?
I'm just a nerd. Sorry.
You're an education nerd.
I'm just an education nerd. Once I'm into it, I'm into it. We have actually had some good meetings this year with other groups that represent different aspects of the children and sort of child welfare sector. So we've spoken to Action for Children, and we've spoken to Become and Young Minds, I think it's called. And like, there's been a lot more conversations going on with other organisations because we recognise we have really a lot of goals in common. But I think for me, and this is just my personal view, I think currently adopters have some leverage.
Yeah.
And if we can put that leverage to good use to benefit as many children as possible on the grounds that adopted children need this and we currently have leverage, so let's get it, knowing that it will benefit children who are adopted and those who are in foster care and those who are in SGO and those who suffered trauma and adverse childhood experiences for other reasons, then we should probably use the leverage we've got to get as much as we can. But I mean, one of the things I've been thinking about recently is can we move away from bringing in individual initiatives to support this group of children or that group of children or the other group of children, and instead coming up with some wholesale change that makes things different for all the children. So it's nice that we have People Premium Plus for adopted children, but what about the kid that sits next to them who's also experienced terrible trauma but doesn't get People Premium Plus because they didn't get adopted?
Yeah.
Something else.
Or the lack of that stuff. But I have to go over to weather with Scott now.
Yes, please do.
Scott...
Oh, sorry. I've
Scott's lapsed into a coma.
Yeah.
This is bread. This is like his daily rant, isn't it?
Yeah. I mean, I just hear all this.
What about you? So tell me, what's been the high point of your year? What, like adoption wise? What's been the good stuff?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I think, as with any year, it's really difficult to say what the highest part was. I think for me, probably again this year, it was a conference. And I mean, it seems like it was ages ago now, and it seems like it was kind of a blip in the year, but actually it just takes so much organising, so much planning, so much kind of bringing together of speakers, of, you know, even getting the venue on board and stuff like that. And I don't do it all myself, so I'm not going to say I do. I mean, I've got a really really supportive kind of help. And
you can save in it all yourself, and they can send us an email if they're cross about it.
No, because I wouldn't. I'm not like that. I'm not like you. You see, I don't like to take all the glory for something that someone else helps with.
Why are you being like this?
That's why you've got an MBE and I haven't.
Oh dear.
As ever, you never please everybody with these things, but you know, just using that opportunity to have people in one room for one day, 350 people, I just get massive amount of kind of, I don't, what's the word,
adoration, just,
no,
exaltation.
No, I get just a massive amount of satisfaction out of doing it. That's exactly it, satisfaction. And also, I feel like I'm in a room with my own people. It's almost like, you know, that alien experience of someone coming, and someone coming from somewhere else and not knowing anybody. And then all of a sudden, you can say anything and just people go, yeah. Not like, oh, well, why don't you try this? Why don't you try that? You know, why don't you...
Have you thought about using sticker charts?
Exactly, yeah, that sort of thing. That's exactly what you don't get. And, you know, that's really important to me because actually, especially like with the older ones, the adults, because yes, we're finding our way through it, but so is everybody else. And there's no, you know, I realised a long time ago there is no one way of doing this. You know, we have to kind of just go with what we know. And I very rarely offer advice these days for that same reason. Mm. I'll offer support and I'll offer sympathy or empathy or, you know, whatever it is that's needed, but I won't offer advice because actually my advice will be very different. And I think that's one thing that I've realized actually during this year is that advice is subjective and it can be helpful and you might take some ideas about how you might fit it around your own family, but actually, you know, it's different for everybody.
I think that's where I've come and done this year with lots of blogs, or not lots of blogs, some blogs. I really, really can't bear advice blogs. It's started to really wind me up. And I just think that, you know, I'm uncomfortable with that, this sort of prescriptive thing. I think I've lost my blogging passion. I think blogging's gone, hasn't it? We were talking about this, weren't we, the other week. I think blogging's had its moment.
I don't read any blogs now. I read the odd one that you do or Becky does, but that's simply because I know you. So I'm like, oh.
Just in case we ask.
Did I get a mention? No. All right. Close it down again.
Did I get a mention? Right. I'm going to write a post and specifically just mention you. I'm just going to write a post that's just entirely your name 50 times.
No, but in all seriousness, I do. I always read, but only because I know you. And that's quite, you know. Other ones, I don't tend to read blogs either. To be perfectly frank, I don't really have time. Yeah. That's the biggest thing for me. So yes, I might have a scroll through if I see a title that I'm interested in. But I've stopped blogging completely now. I do a blog if I'm asked to do one, if that makes sense. So actually, that's probably one of the other big things of this year. Heads Together asked me to do a blog on suicide and mental health for it was a couple of weeks ago now. And Heads Together, for anybody that doesn't know, is the charity for mental health. And their patrons are the Duke and Duchess of wherever.
You need to get this right.
Wow. William and Kate.
You've got
William
this
and Kate. Invited round, get the names right. Yes.
William and Kate.
I'm going to name check. Wow. Do it.
On the money.
West Sussex. Yeah. Duke and Duchess of Sussex, isn't it? I think. Anyway, they'll be writing in now. They'll be banging on them keyboards, complaining. And Prince.
You know, those adopters like the royals, don't they?
Anyway. Oof. No, it's not even that. Do you know what it is? It's the Duke and Duchess of Cambridge, which I should know because I live 10 miles from it. That's Kate and Wales, isn't it? Because Harry and Meghan are completely different, aren't they? That's where I'm getting confused.
Yeah.
My brain's all... But that's the only time I do them is if I'm asked to guess now. And, you know, I'm quite happy to do that. No problem. Because I don't have I don't have to check my Google Analytics to see how many times it's not been read by anybody. So, you know, let somebody else worry about it. And if it's useful, it's useful. If it's not, I've got nothing to lose, you know. So, I've fallen out of love for blogs.
Yeah, they have the purpose, but I don't know. I just think it's maybe had its moment. But I also wonder as well that there's a natural cycle to these things, isn't there? That for me, I reached a zenith maybe this time last year, and then I kind of thought, and I purposefully thought, I want to get off this sort of treadmill a bit, because I don't know about you, Becky, but I kind of felt the times a bit like a treadmill. Oh, I've got to
do something this week, got to do something every week. Yeah. I think I reached a point where I actually said most of the things I wanted to say and was having to go, what can I write about this week? What can I write?
Yeah.
And when I'm doing that, I'm like, well, who wants to read? No one wants to read things that I've had to dredge out of the bottom of my brain to write about.
Yeah.
If there's something compelling that needs to be said, well, I can say that. But frankly, if I have nothing compelling to say, I should probably just not.
Yeah.
A novel concept for me, but I'm working on it.
Good advice. I'm going to write that down and remind you of that the next time we're together for work.
You've got it on tape. You don't need to write it down. You've got it on tape. Just hit that audio clip.
Yeah.
Put it on your phone and play it to me whenever you want. Yeah.
Make it your ringtone.
And what we'll do as well is we'll also say my name and show you a picture of my face so you remember who I am.
That'll be helpful, thank you. In case I ever run into you at the green room at Radio 4.
Yeah, but I think you're right, Al. These things do have a natural kind of end to them sometimes. I mean, people will continue to blog, and there will be blogs that, you know, there will be an increase again at some point. But for me, I just don't have the time, in all honesty. And, you know,
I think there are some good blogs happening now, and there are some. New people writing blogs quite prolifically that weren't on the scene 3 or 4 or 5 years ago when we started out, or were a bit more prolific. And I think you, as a in your life, you probably go through seasons of needing to write and seasons of needing to read, depending on what you know. And I certainly think if you're fairly new into the adoption world, I think a lot of people in that situation might be voracious readers of blogs. It depends what you want, what you want out of a blog, really. I never really followed blogs that were, not because I don't agree with them or anything, but it just doesn't appeal to me, that are basically descriptions of people's lives and the things that they do, particularly. Although occasionally I'll read one if it's got an interesting title or something.
Yeah.
And
nice picture.
And again, I've not, although I've occasionally written them, I've stopped writing them. I'm not a massive reader of ones that are like 10 top tips for doing this or 10 top tips for managing that, because as you said, I don't know, advice is, sometimes you'll read them and you'll pick up something and think, oh yeah, actually I could probably try that. And then other times you read them and think, no, yeah, I don't think that's quite, that's not necessarily hitting the mark for me.
Yeah.
And I think our circumstances and our children are so individual and we go through seasons of our life that are so different. That I'm not sure. I did write a blog post. One of my most recent ones was something like, zero top tips for dating while being an adoptive parent or something.
Oh, I loved that. That was brilliant. I did love that blog.
I just really thought this must be a shared experience. But there must be other adopters out there who've adopted as a single person and have then met somebody and tried to sort of navigate that. This must be an experience that people might want to connect with. But what can I really say in terms of giving advice to people about it? Nothing, absolutely nothing, because this is just what I did. And a lot of it was catastrophic. And like, it's a miracle it works. It's a miracle we're still together. You know what I mean? That it even got beyond the first date, which... Well, the second day,
it was a disaster.
It was really hard to navigate. And it's like, and also the advice I would probably have given myself in advance, I didn't follow any of it. So how can I possibly give that advice to somebody else? So I just, the more I live as an adoptive parent, the less likely I am to want to tell people what they should be doing, I think, because I've failed to follow my own advice that often. Why would anybody else be interested?
Yeah, historically, my most popular blogs are the ones where I confess to doing something outrageously stupid.
I find that very hard to believe, that you would do anything stupid.
Oh, no, I just say stupid things to my kids and they just look at me like I'm an idiot, and I think people take solace in the fact that...
Al, it's not just your kids that do that, right? You do it every day as well, yeah.
I do think there's something lovely to be said, though, for a community where... We can go, oh my word, I messed it up so bad today. And everyone can go, yeah. I was having a lovely conversation on Twitter the other night that somebody was, they were having a really difficult time. And I can't remember whether the child was sick or, they just were having a really difficult time. And they were feeling guilty because they'd let the kid watch a load of television that day. And about 50 people came on and went, don't feel guilty about that. Completely fine. My kids watched, and then just like horror stories, and my kids watched Peppa Pig for 12 hours, or no one said that. But, you know, people just saying, you know, look, like, in real parenting land, sometimes your kid's going to watch Peppa Pig for 3 hours while you lie on the floor with an ice pack on your head, and that's how you're going to survive that day. And then the next day, maybe you pick yourself up and try and do something different, but that's okay. And I must admit, blogs like that, or I think that's probably why you get a lot of hits for that kind of thing, because any admission that we're not actually robots cheers me up no end, which is the reason I don't read a lot of advice books on adoptive parenting, because they all seem to assume that we as the parents are just some kind of like automaton that can continually radiate calm, never lose our right. And scream our heads off because there was a sock under the radiator, or you know, completely random.
Well, I'm a perfect parent compared to you, then.
Well, I mean, apart from you, Scott, you know,
you're an inspiration to me. My more popular blogs is the one where I accidentally started this conversation around why someone
cheese toasties.
What? No, do you know, but the cheese toasty, do you know, I'll get back to that. The cheese toasty, there has been a healing.
I've missed that story and no one will tell me what it's about.
We can't really speak of it, for it was painful. However, the person who blocked me over the cheese sandwich...
Painfully funny or just painful?
Painfully funny.
The story was that I can't go there.
We'll go there a day when it's just the three of us before we start recording.
I've been unblocked on Twitter.
Oh, okay.
So I'm back in the fold with the person, and it looks like as long as we don't talk about cheese or toasties or cheese toasties, everything's going to be okay. But no, but I was saying
that's a little story of Christmas cheer, isn't it? For Christmas season. For the festive period. How lovely. But,
cheese toasties.
Cheese toasties. No, but
peace and reconciliation.
No, and it was all okay in the end. But I had this conversation with my kids where one of them said, one of our friends was adopting. She went, is she adopting? I went, yeah. And she said, well, why is she adopting? I said, well, they've decided they want to take some children who don't have a family. Oh, why are they taking the children? I said, well... So I had this moment of inspiration where I thought of this analogy around children who are picked for sports. And I went, well, sometimes children don't get picked for sports. It's like the children who are left at the end. And they wanted to choose... and like,
watching a car crash.
Well, I was driving, and my son... So my son, Ginger, was there, and the three kids in the back listened to me. And I thought, what... I was saying, and so it's like they've chosen the children who no one else wants to choose, and the kids went, oh, so you like adopted kids are rubbish then? And I just...
God.
I just... My son looked at me like I'm just... with pity. He looked at me with pity, as if to say, how can anyone be just so stupid?
I mean, were your kids trolling you then, or were they genuinely asking?
No, they were asking me, but then they sensed I was on the rocks and went for the kill, basically.
They know how to do it, don't they?
They sang me onto the rocks so they could crush me and then use it like in their counselling sessions when they're 45 and go, my father said this.
My dad said this.
Can I just ask, does your son know that you call him Ginger?
You've met my son, haven't you?
Yeah, I have, but does he know you call him Ginger?
I don't think he... It doesn't pay any attention to me whatsoever, I don't
know. No, that's true, actually, to be fair. Nor do any of the other kids, to be fair.
That's true. And frankly, it's worked out fine for us up to now. We've covered all kinds of things. Do you think we should maybe move on to the Christmas quiz?
Yeah, because my Baileys has run out.
No, I don't think we should.
Right, so in that case, we will.
I'm basically thirsty. I'm thirsty now.
Right.
Have you not got your butler there that you can clap your hands and go, drinky?
Well, he has returned, actually, but it's...
You need a bell, Becky. You need a bell.
No, I can't attract his attention without exploding the microphone.
Dave, bring
us... Oh, you're getting here.
Bring me my Baileys.
Get me some more Baileys.
Baileys and a kebab. Classy.
Oh, yeah.
Ooh.
Living the dream.
Right, go on then. Go on, Cole.
So this is a Christmas quiz based on an adoption theme. and it's called Memoir or Made Up. Now, I'm going to read out the names of books from the internet where people have written their adopter memoir. And it's the title.
Oh, no.
Right? So, but the
people might be actually listening that actually wrote those books, well, and now we're going to humiliate and offend them on the actual podcast.
No, there is a caveat to this.
They've got better things.
I'm going to be defriended, aren't I, on Twitter?
Yeah, well, welcome to my life.
Unfollowed or whatever.
Right, there is a caveat that anyone who can be bothered to write a book, more power to you. You're an absolute freaking star. Anyone who can be bothered to put their story out there, I'm in absolute admiration as someone who's meant to be writing a book and has secretly hidden from the publishers and blocked their emails. But anyway, that's another story for another time. So this is no disrespect to them. Absolute, proper respect them. So I'm going to give you the name of an adoption memoir, and you have to tell me, I'm going to give you a couple of options, and you have to tell me which one's made up and which one is the real name of a memoir, okay?
Okay.
Is there any doubt about what we're doing?
No, it's good.
Right.
Just go
ahead. It's going to go wrong, whatever way it happens. So.
Bourbon,
right, okay.
or bourbon.
You're both wrong. It's bourbon.
Right. Here's the first one. So listen carefully. Please pay attention. Right. Here's the one of these.
Unlikely.
One of these is made up. One of them is not. You can adopt without debt. Creative ways to cover the cost of adoption. That's the first
That's
option.
True.
Hang on, the
That's
first option.
True.
The wait. The second one is adoption, poor and unhappy. So which one? Which one's
I think
false?
The first one's true.
Yeah, I think the first one. It's probably.
It
American,
sounds like an American
so,
book.
Yeah.
It is an American book. Yeah, you're right. Absolutely right. So you got that bang on the nose, right?
I think I've got it. No, I have.
This, right?
You wrote it. You wrote it.
I wrote it.
Well, that was a warmer upper. Warmer upper? That was a just to get you going, get your juices flowing, get you in the zone. The second one is this. So are you ready?
Bring it.
Right, bring it. The Laughing Rabbit. A mother, a son, and the ties that bind. Right? So that's again.
Laughing Rabbit.
Right, listen. Just listen, don't. Or
don't butt in, Becky. Shush.
Or The Weeping Boy. A child and a mother 1,000 miles apart. So we've got The Laughing Rabbit, a mother, a son, and the ties that bind, or The Weeping Boy, a child and a mother 1,000 miles apart.
Probably the second one, I would say.
Which one's
made
up?
I hope it's the second one.
Which one's
both
made up?
Sound quite, I was going to say the first one. Which one's made up?
Yeah, which one's made up?
The first one sounds more like a sex kind of book.
What?
Oh, God.
That's all I was thinking.
Scott,
that word rabbit, you should never put rabbit in a title, that's all I'm saying.
Scott, shut up. Your career is disappearing in front of me.
Oh,
so choose one, The Laughing Rabbit or The Weeping Boy.
Choose one to be true or choose one
choose
to be made
one to
up.
Be either, just as long as you clarify. Which one is made up?
I think the
first one.
First one, yeah.
No, it is a real book.
Gosh.
The Laughing Rabbit, a mother, a son, and the ties that bind.
So, I must let myself be swayed by Scott on that one.
Right, okay.
Yeah. And apologies to the writer of that book.
We
you know,
can easily learn.
Yeah.
It's in the
it's
adult,
my mind.
Adult
my
section.
Mind is in the gutter.
Yes,
obviously.
Again. So we're quickly moving on. Third question. Adoption. Choosing it. Living it. Loving it. Or adoption. Learning how to love. So, we've got adoption, choosing it, living it, loving it, or adoption, learning how to love. Which one is false?
No. I'm inclined to say the first one's false, but
I think it's a clever double bluff.
Yeah, exactly. And also...
it might be.
Actually, you would put that as a title of a book, because actually... but it's just difficult at times. But you know what I'm saying? It's that kind of.
Just give me an answer. I'm bored of you.
No, I can't.
I'm about to give Scott a grade C for his critical analysis of the.
That's very generous of you.
Whatever. I don't really
care. I think the first one's the true one.
You are correct. The first one is. I made up the second one, Adoption Learning How to Love, because I thought that was cheesy.
That is quite cheesy and
it is, yeah.
Very feasible.
Yeah, a bit like Mr. Coates. So.
All right, okay. Now we're getting into the difficult ones, so here we go.
Oh, God.
Right, right. The first one is Chasing Kites, One Mother's Unexpected Journey Through Infertility, Adoption and Foster Care. It's probably the wrong order, isn't it? Adoption, foster care. Anyway. Or Catching Clouds, A Journey from Infinity to Adoption. Not infinity, infertility. Can't read my own writing. Can't read my own typing. That's even worse, isn't it? So, Chasing Kites, One Mother's Unexpected Journey Through Infertility, Adoption and Foster Care. Or Catching Clouds, A Journey from Infertility to Adoption.
I would say the second one is real because I think you fluffed up on the first one there because you said adoption and fostering the wrong way around, and that's likely the thing you would do. So,
I think I might say the second one is real because so far it's been mostly the first one that was real, and I think I'm ready for a change.
Well, Becky, you're right. Hang on. Which one did you say was real? The first one is real.
The same.
Yeah, Becky is right. The first one is right, and the second one is wrong.
No, I was wrong. I said the second one. Scott was right.
I said the first one was wrong because you made an arse of your tile.
The first one is real. Did I? Well, I can't remember what I said.
Oh, there. I can't remember what I said. Can we move on? Because I'm getting bored of this as well. I prefer bourbon or bourbon. You're both wrong. It's bourbon.
Right. This is an easy one for you. Chicken Soup for the Adopted Soul. Stories celebrating forever families. Or Chocolate Hobnobs. Wait. Don't interrupt. Or Chocolate Hobnobs and a Cup of Tea. One adopter's descent into madness after trying to achieve an EHCP plan for their child.
Come on. The name of Becky's book.
Boom.
Oh, dear.
Well, I think we know which one is real and which one's not.
Alan, you've given it away now.
I think we know what the one...
I think the first one is real, but the second one should be a book.
Yeah, it should be. And it probably will be now that Al said it. In fact, it's probably the book that Al is writing at the minute that he's delaying.
Right. I've got lots more, but I'm going to keep going. Moving Heaven and Earth, A Personal Journey into International Adoption, or Moving Heaven and Earth, Adoption on the Allotment.
Oh, my days.
Adoption on the Allotment. That's a clever pun.
I wouldn't go so far as clever.
All right, that's a pun. Infantile pun.
I
think the first one is the real one.
Yeah.
Are they just all the first one is the real one? Because make the rest of this much easier.
Right, I'm going to go... This is going to be the final one. Actually, yeah. So here we go. I'm going to give you three titles. Some of them are false. Some of them are correct. Three titles. The first one, which you might appreciate. Unicycle. Adoption for the Single Christian Mom. Or Tandem. A Devotional for Adopting with God in the Lead. Or...
Come on, I'll hold it together.
It's not even funny. No biking in the house without a helmet.
What? Oh, dear.
Yeah, so we've got Unicycle, Adoption for the Single Christian Mom, Tandem, A Devotional for Adopting with God in the Lead, or No Biking in the House Without a Helmet. So some of them are false and some of them are true, honestly.
Are they?
Yes.
Are they really?
Well, have a guess. Which one do you think is false?
The first one is definitely a book. I mean, that is definitely a book. The cycling metaphor is a well-done metaphor in Christian parents in circles, I have to say. The first two sound completely legit to me.
Right, fair enough. Okay, well, so you've got... What about you, Scott?
I'm kind of not getting involved in this one, to be honest with you. Because of fear of mocking my newfound faith friends. So.
you're staying resilient.
The third one, The third one sounds a bit far out there.
Right. Okay. Well, I'll tell you the second.
I think really the clue is that if Al nearly wets himself before he reads it out, that's probably the one.
Because I'm laughing at my own joke.
So much at his own joke.
Well, actually,
the giveaway.
No, it's not true. The first one. So, No Biking in the House Without a Helmet is a book. It's a book. It's a memoir of an adoptive dad, I believe. The second one, Tandem, a devotional for adopting with God in the lead, is a legitimate book. And then the first one, Unicycle, Adoption for the Single Christian.
Is
one I made up.
You made that? Like, honestly.
And that's the one that I thought would have been more likely.
I would 100% believe that to be a book.
I've got so many mother. All right.
Wow.
I've got
you
so many more.
You just basically think Becky's coming on the podcast. Let's write this.
No, honestly, if you've ever got a spare 10 minutes, just Google adoption memoirs, and the names are hilarious. And the final question: bourbon or bourbon? No, I'll not go there.
No, let's not go there because you might get a slap.
Get a slap down the phone. So what's the new year going to bring? Becky, you're getting married. What other than that? What are your hopes and aspirations for 2019?
Other than getting married, all right. I've not really thought beyond that. I don't know. I think my family's changing. I stopped fostering this year. Mm. I had a little foster child with me until May. And after that, I resigned my registration.
Was that tricky?
And so I think it was tricky because what's hilarious about it is I had to send my resignation in by writing, which I did. And now on a fortnightly basis, my local authority sends me an email requesting me to complete mandatory GDPR data protection training. So I just think it's ironic.
You've had no contact with them since you left.
Yeah, considering they shouldn't have my details on their database anymore for that purpose, which I'm not. I'm just allowing it to happen and laughing quietly every 2 weeks at how inept. But anyway, that's funny. So I think for me, for 2019 heralds the first year that I've experienced my children growing up and we went nappy free this year.
Oh,
my house is nappy free for the first time in 7.5 years, which is really very excellent.
Wonderful.
And to think that we're not going back to that anymore. I've been clearing the house out of baby equipment, carts and prams and baby clothes and all the stuff that we've acquired. And just to think now that we're starting from 2019 onwards will be our first year of everyone in our house just keeps getting older and we don't keep replacing them with younger children.
It's kind of a new way of
being, yeah.
Embracing.
I don't know,
normal.
It's just more normal. I think we're just going to be more normal. Ha ha ha.
Sounds really great.
Whatever that looks like.
What about you, Scott? Yeah. What are you going to do next year? What are your hopes and aspirations? Aren't you getting married?
Apparently. Although we decided the other day we really should start organising it and maybe book a venue as well.
Just traditionalists.
Yeah, last minute traditionalists. Done the same with Christmas. What are we, the 20th of December, and I haven't done any Christmas shopping at all.
What could go on?
Apart from he's bought some Bailey's cream, which I will not eat because I don't like alcohol in food. You will be surprised to know that.
Explains why you're thin though, doesn't it?
Yeah, exactly. But I think for me, I don't know. I really don't know. Yes, I'm getting married. I just want to get through another year, to be honest with you. And I think that what's interesting about this last 12 months is I've not been... every week has been a different week for me in this last 12 months, work-wise, I mean. And I've not really been feeling... What's the word I'm using? Because it's changed so much every week, and I'm deadly serious. It's been up one week, down the next, and then up the next, and then down. I've not felt comfortable. But over the last the last 4 weeks, I've kind of felt that I'm actually getting to grips with my job again. If that makes sense.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm just hopeful that, as we go into next year, things are a little bit more settled, and I can kind of do the job that I do rather than trying to do something that, is up and down every day. So
it's been a bit chaotic, hasn't it, your life as well?
Yeah.
House move and stuff, so that's cool.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So a little bit more settled next year, please.
Excellent.
Although we will be moving again in May.
Oh, tish tash tosh.
Because obviously we're only here for 6 months, but we'll worry about that. We're only supposed to be moving 2 days after we get married. Not sure how that's going to work out.
That's madness.
You're just
lunatics, absolute lunatics.
No, we moved. I mean, we moved 2 days after the conference, and it worked out all right.
Yeah, yeah.
Apart from the fact we both had flu since, like, constantly, for the last 4 weeks. So yeah, but it'll be fine. Apart, you know, what can happen?
The physical and psychological collapse, whatever.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, we'll be dead by June.
Excellent. Well, as long as you pay for the wedding.
Yeah, exactly. Fine. Yeah, it's all sorted.
That'll be all
fine.
It'll be fine, won't it?
What about you, Al? What about you for 2019? Please don't go on too long, because we're bored of you.
Can you hear Tris chuckling in the background?
Yeah, he heard you chuckling in the background.
Yeah, bless him. Yeah. No, I've got no.
I get paid for speaking.
Oh, he's saying, does he get royalties for speaking?
No, he doesn't.
No, you don't, because I don't get royalties for speaking.
So it's about me. I think that I am just wanting to kind of keep the momentum going. There seems like a lot of really interesting stuff going around challenging violent aggressive behaviour. So that's really boring and dull, isn't it? I know it sounds really, really boring, but I just want to be, I want to have all my kids still with me by the end of the year. Does that sound really pessimistic?
It sounds worthy and realistic, Al, I think.
We've had an interesting year. I was thinking about it, because I was thinking, you know, this time last year I'd lost a daughter, and now this time this year I've found her, literally, raked the streets, found her, and now I've got two grandchildren. I think, blimey, what can change in a year? So I am just really hoping to have all of my children kind of with us, which that's a really crap ending to the podcast, isn't it? That's just miserable. It's
not. Listen, we could sit here and talk about all the negatives, couldn't we? Because, you know, I don't want to have to go and, you know, sit in the magistrate's court while my son is charged with what he was charged with next year. Do you know what I mean? It's that kind of thing. So I'm with you. And, you know, one of mine doesn't live with us anymore because he's moved out, and that's fantastic because he's independent and blah, blah, blah. But there's always that risk he might come home. But, you know, it's just, we're all different. We all have different needs and wants and family setups, and things suit us, things don't. So I get what you mean. I think I'm very grateful this year in terms of, you know, the fact that we've had communication from birth family, but it hasn't made any difference. You know, we're still a family.
It's not been negative.
Yeah.
It's not been collapsed, the whole house of cards. That's really
exactly
good.
and that's you know, that's the way our lives are as a community, isn't it? It's all ups and downs. You know, both my boys were sacked on Wednesday from their jobs at the same time as they finished shifts, and it's just like, oh, here we go again. You know, we're on that cycle again. And rather than getting upset and angry and panicked and anxious and all that sort of stuff, I went, oh well, you know, after 5 minutes of being anxious and angry and all that sort of stuff, but you know, that's just the way our lives are, isn't it? And there's nothing we can do to change it.
Well, I think that's one thing I've learned this year, is that to an extent, I can't track my children's emotion. I can't track through their experience from my perspective, because it grinds me to dust. So you know, there's times when one of my children had kind of disappeared, and it kind of dawned on me that I thought, if I thought my daughter was sat in some terrible situation, kind of desperate for me to come and get her, I would go in a moment. And I was kind of thinking, I was putting myself in her situation, but actually it wasn't an issue for her at all. She was kind of happy with the circumstances, and I thought, right, well, in that case, I've got to I can't track with her through this experience. You know, it's all, you know, I found her and did bring her back, but you know, it's funny games. Yeah. But like you say, it reflects the nature of contemporary adoption, doesn't it? Our expectations are very different to our peers.
Exactly.
Well,
and on that note,
we've got a very special guest for the Queen's speech this year, haven't we?
We do.
Friend of the show.
Bless. Yeah. Well, she's not been on the show, actually.
She's been on one of the voices, though. She's been an adopter voice. She was the very
first
one.
Yes, she has, yeah.
Not without
controversy. So, obviously, we've had. Well, you were the Queen's speech last year, weren't you, Becky?
Yeah.
Which I love that, because it's like when I'm listening to it, I think I'm really listening to the Queen's speech, and then you've got this Mancunian woman.
Hey up, then.
Yeah, exactly.
It'll be Christmas-like.
Yeah, exactly. And I just loved it. So this year we've got Glitter Nails.
Yeah.
Oh.
And she's recorded us a little Christmas message.
Bless her heart.
Oh. Bless her heart.
Yes. So.
So.
Shall we say our goodbyes and then we'll fade into the message?
Yeah, I think we should. Yes,
well, Becky,
I think we should.
Have a cracking year. Thank you for tracking with us and coming on the podcast. Scott, yeah. I'm increasingly able to tolerate you, so that's good. and I hope you survive the Christmas.
Probably not. I'll be drunk most of it, I would imagine. But, you know, not that I'm advocating drinking or anything like that.
No.
But yes, I will probably be, you know, quite drunk.
Drink responsibly.
Yeah. And Al, thank you for another fab year on the podcast and for being so innovative and, you know, helping the team to develop it.
I'm so sincere.
The problem is, right, in some way or another, and then we come on and do this stuff and it's like, it's just, my guard goes completely down and I just become a complete arse, but still in work mode, because my brain is telling me you work with these guys as well. So I do apologize. You're both amazing and I thank you for an amazing year, and I thank all our listeners for an amazing year as well.
Yes.
And I hope that, you know, even if it's just one podcast that's raised a little, you know, a little smile in you, then I've done my job.
Excellent. Yeah. Well, look after yourself, Becky. Look after yourself, Scott, and have a cracking Christmas.
Thank you, guys. Merry Christmas, everybody.
Merry Christmas, everyone. I said I was going to sing. Snow is falling all around.
Okay, wind it up, Al.
Yep. Children play.
Where's the off button?
Listen, I've been bah humbug up till now. No, you can't stop me. It's unleashed.
I'll fade that out, don't worry.
Hello, I'd like by saying how honoured and surprised I was at being asked to record the Alternative Queen speech. I can only presume everyone else was busy. This year's Alternative Queen speech comes with added glitter, because after all, glitter is not just for Christmas. 2018 has been a busy year in the world of adoption, with many issues highlighted in the media. To me, it felt like the adoption community have all really stepped up and come together to be one much louder voice, some of us much louder than others. The year started with the announcement that there was to be a new MBE awarded, our very own bourbon-loving, check shirt and hat-wearing Mr. Coates, for services to family and children. And along with Sally Donovan and Jenny Jones, one of the original adoptive parents who began to challenge the DfE many moons ago. The talk turned to, would he remove his hat at the palace, and would they supply bourbon biscuits? It is at this point I feel the good Lady C needs a mention for her Lifetime Achievement Award for putting up supporting Mr. Coates' MBE. As they say, behind every good man is a better person. This summer we lived through the heat wave comparable to the one in the 1976. It seems so far removed from the grey days and dark afternoons of now. The heat wasn't just coming from the weather, but also from the publication of the report by Al Coates, now Al Coates MBE, and Dr. Wendy Thorley on child-to-parent violence, or as they have decided to rename it, CCAVB. This was the first publication that hit the adoption community and the world with hard facts, evidence and statistics on what far too many adoptive families were facing. It was a bold and brave move to open up to the previous taboo subject with warts and all to the world, but it was needed. The statistics did not shock anyone in the adoption bubble, but brought home what so many families were living with day to day. The stories on Twitter were heartbreaking, but the support shown by everyone was humbling. As with each autumn, we all have to go through the same experience, year after year of transitions and the dreaded return to school, changes to school, and for some, starting school for the first time. Many parents breathed a huge sigh of relief and others lied and said how much they would miss their child while inside having a mini party. My relief about my son returning to school was somewhat delayed due to relocating and a new school needing to be found. Who knew 12 weeks and 3 days out of school could seem like a lifetime? I do now. I wish I could say I parted when Jay returned to school, but I lay down in a dark room for a while. Education is always on the minds of the adopters. School for so many children can be difficult, traumatic, and for others just impossible. Some schools and teachers really do try to understand. They're open-minded, willing to learn, they listen, and they put the children at the centre. School can still be so hard for so many of our children, but seeing schools who at least try lifts my heart. Other schools lose their ears, eyes and minds to children and stay in the 1900s. We then move on to Halloween, which saw some monsters on the big screen from Gift Gaff's biggest blunder. For those who missed the furlough, I can only guess you had escaped to sunnier climates with Scott to keep him company on one of his very many holidays this year, or were still partying from the return to school celebration. Twitter went into meltdown. The National Grid took a beating and adopters did what no one thought was possible and got the advert pulled. I have to thank Gift Gaff for doing what a large international corporate organisation never does. They listened, they read, they held their hands up, they worked with Adoption UK to learn. Gift Gaff then produced a short video to raise awareness of adoption, the adoption community and Adoption UK. You may have seen a large pumpkin looking orange t-shirt wearing adopter on it. Not sure who that could have been. This then leads me on to another huge feat from the wonderful world of adoption. I shall call this Get Gay Adoption Dad to Wear a Tutu. As the name suggests, the challenge was to get Scott to wear a tutu on stage at the annual conference. It is amazing how one photo can turn 60 hours into a hub of activity, a fundraising idea, and see amazing passion come from adopters all over the world. Hopefully you will have seen the campaign across Facebook and Twitter, but if you missed it because you were still partying from the return to school, shame on you. Or am I just a little bit jealous that you still have the energy to party? Anyway, the photo was of a little girl wearing a tutu. At Team Rinsey posted it and said, if only life was so simple. Bang! An explosion, well, a glitter ball, went off in my head and an idea was formed. We could wear tutus at the conference. The challenge was thrown down to Scott, or Gay Adoption Dad, as he is on Twitter, and he batted it back with a counter-challenge that if £1,000 could be raised by Saturday morning, he would wear a tutu at the conference. Now, any of you who know me know I love glitter and possibly a challenge. Not for 1 minute did I think that this could be achieved. Suddenly, Twitter became alive, and not only did the challenge grow legs, but it became a millipede and ran. So many adopters and non-adopters got involved. They tweeted, they shared the post, they donated. Any famous post adopter we could think of were asked to share the posts. I couldn't keep up. I had RSA from trying to tweet so much. I purchased a said tutu, but due to time constraints, could only get a very short see-through tutu. Thank goodness Scott is not a true Scotsman. Oh wait, Houston, we may have had a problem. The buzz around the conference and the tutu was incredible. It felt like everyone had come together to have fun. Sometimes adoption can be intense, can be upsetting, frustration, sad, make us angry, make us feel isolated and lonely. This challenge just seemed to lift everyone, put some laughs into our day and brought people together with one common cause, to make Scott wear a tutu. I have to say a huge, huge thank you to everyone as over £1,500 was raised in less than 3 days. Thank you also to Scott for being a good sport and wearing the tutu, but thank goodness he kept his trousers on. I was delighted to be able to help out at the conference on the day. There are lots of adoptive families who depend on online support as they just can't make it to these type of events. The conference was a real sense of community, where the virtual world and real world came together with the meeting of virtual friends and the, oh, that's you, comments from all around the room. That was quickly followed by, you must come and meet. Very surreal, as no one looks like their Twitter photo. Community is a big part of our community, whether online or face-to-face, as we all need it, and we all thrive, cry, support, advise, listen, etc. Even the podcast is part of this community. I love hearing the different guests from all across the world of fostering and adoption. Their experience and views always leave me with questions and points to ponder on. Add to this the banter between the hosts and it's a great listen. Going into 2019, I wish all of the adoption community a peaceful Christmas as possible. Yet another difficult time of year for us all. But remember, we're all here for each other. Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.